Next, we will see constraints in database. So what is what and why of constraints? We'll start with this one. So what are constraints? Constraints are the rules which we enforce it on the columns. Why do we need to enforce the rules on the columns? At the time of defining the table, during the table, when you define the table, right, or when you define or when you create the table definition, at the time of table definition itself, if you enforce the rules, such as, let's say my I have Aadhaar number or social security number, this column should not have null values in it. Prevent storing the null values in the Aadhaar number. It is a mandatory column. Similarly, in the case of insurance, the age is mandatory column. It should not have null values. But if you allow the user to store the null values without enforcing any rules, or at the application side itself, if you don't validate. Supposing you have an application, the application, when you enter the age and other detail, sometimes what will happen before you submit it, or when you try to submit it, it will throw an error. It will say the age is blank, please enter age. So application side itself, they do the validation. Sometimes what will happen, in some cases, the application level itself, they don't validate certain columns. In that case, what will happen is, let's say in the Aadhaar number is a blank value, and in the application, let's say you are booking the movie ticket or something, their Aadhaar number is important, let us assume that way, or social security number is important. That column is, even if you leave it blank, still you are able to book a ticket for a movie. It should not be null, but whereas you made it, you did not enter anything. And when you submit it, the data gets stored in the table, but in the table, the Aadhaar number is not available, null value is there. The application side itself, they are supposed to prevent the users to leave the blank space in the Aadhaar number column. It is like a social security number. So, okay, in the application side, they did not do validation, at least from the back end, at the database side, when you store the data in the table, it should not allow the blank values in the table. In this case, we use not null constraint to enforce the rule. Which rule? To prevent storing the null values in the mandatory columns. Mandatory column, you are supposed to have values in it. To prevent null values to get stored, we enforce some rule, not null. For example, Aadhaar number, I have a column Aadhaar, or passport number. The passport number supposed to be not null. Okay. While storing the data itself, if we enforce the users, or if you enforce it at the table definition itself, you will not have the messy data in your data set. You are not supposed to have blank values. You are not supposed to have a duplicate records. To avoid duplicate records, we use primary key and foreign key. Sorry, primary key and unique key. So primary key column, when you define a primary key on a column, you cannot store duplicate values in that column. For example, you have a passport number. The passport number is something like PAX023, the passport number. Okay, so again, this passport number is, let's say, Alan. This guy's name is Alan, and his passport number is this one. Okay, so first of all, the passport column should not have blank values. No blank values and no duplicate values. Same passport ID should not be used by other person. Let's say you are traveling by flight. Okay, so in that case, if somebody else is using your passport number, what will happen? It is a big risk. Okay, so in the using primary key, we are enforcing the records to store unique values, store only unique values, and also when you store the unique values, you will not have the duplicate records, and you are not supposed to have blank values, not null as well as no duplicate. And also using primary key, we can uniquely identify the records in a table. So in this case, the employed is the primary key column. So if you look at here, for each employee ID, we have a unique employee ID. For each employee, we have unique ID here. Supposing, why should I have a unique ID here? Let's say I have another gentleman whose name is also John. Okay, he is also working in the department number 10, but his salary is different. His salary is something like 25,000. This John is different, this John is different. But in the same department, two employee names are same. So how do I distinguish this employee from this employee? Let's say his employee ID is 104. With this employee ID, we can uniquely identify a row in the table. And also, the primary key column should not be having any null values, and also you should have a unique values in it. That is what primary key is all about. Okay? And the next one is, now you understood what is primary key and not null. Not null is something like, as I told you, in this age, let's say you have age of the employee, you have another column, the age of the employee should not be null, or date of joining, let's say no date of joining, it should have values in it, it should not be blank. Okay, not null. Not null constraint, primary key. Using primary key, you can uniquely identify the records. Likewise, same person, in the same department, two employees' names are same, but in order to distinguish a specific John based on the employee only, we can uniquely identify the record, right? Uniquely identify a specific person or specific instance. Next one is foreign key. What is foreign key? This is another table. Look at here. So this is a department table. So in this department table, the department number is the primary key. And in this case, employee ID is the primary key in this table. Okay. So, but in the employee table itself, we have a column by the name of department number. The values in this department number column comes from outside of this table. It is coming from department table. So whatever the depart number values are there here, the same value should be here. But it can have duplicate values here. But whatever values are there in this table, in this table's depart number column, the same value should be here. Supposing, let's say you have something like 999. The department number, you got some value 999, but the corresponding value is not available. Okay. So in order to avoid some kind of anomalies like this, right? So put some, say later point in time, if you wanted to find out, I wanted to see the list of employees working in all the departments. Give me a report which shows all the employees working in all the departments. Department wise, I want to see the employee names. In that case, what will happen, since this, there is no department number by 999 is available here, it will show this employee name. But people will be scratching on the head. So which department he belongs to? One employee is falling in this one, it is fine. So in order to avoid these kind of anomalies, what they do is they create the foreign key constraint. Whatever the values are there here in this table's primary key column, the same value should be here. But it can be duplicated here. Foreign key can have duplicates, but the values should come from the outside of the table. In this case, the outside table is department. So this is what foreign key is all about. And also to enforce this, we create the constraint. Look here. If you look at my table creation script, which I shared it to you all. In the employee table, you can see something like primary key. In this case, the employee number is the primary key column. Look here. So the employee ID, in this case, employee ID, but here employee number. This is the primary key. I defined it using this keyword. Forget about this one at this moment. Next one is foreign key. At the table definition itself, I mentioned the foreign key. In this table, I have a department number column. This department number column should references department table's department number. So this column should references the department table's department number column's values. In that case, even if you try to insert 999 or some other value, right, in this department number, it will not get inserted. It will throw an error. Even if you try to insert it, let's say you are trying to insert 999 in this table column, what will happen is it will throw an error. It says that foreign key constraint violation. Right? And also the foreign key allows us to establish a relationship between two tables. So this is the foreign key. So in this table, the department number is the primary key, but in the employee table, the department number is the foreign key. Using this foreign key, we can create the relationship between two tables. Why should I create a relationship between two tables? If I wanted to query the data from these two tables, for example, I wanted to display employee name and department name together in my report, I need to join these two tables. In order to join these two tables, I need to combine these two tables using the common column between these two tables. The common column between these two tables are department number. Only when you join this, you can. So in this case, what we do is we create a foreign key relationship. With the help of the foreign key, we are able to combine or join this table. Okay. It helps us to establish the relationship between tables. Next one is unique key constraint. Unique key constraint is also same as primary key constraint, but the difference is, same as primary key constraint, but the difference is, like primary key, you can store unique values, but it allows you to store one null value in that table. Why should I store null value? It shows a unique value, but why should I store null value in the unique constraint column? The example is phone number. Not all the people have phone number, isn't it? You can enforce unique constraint on a phone number column, but there are some people, right? One person, is not having phone number. In that case, what you do is use unique constraint. Unique constraint is used to ensure that no duplicate values will be inserted into a specific column, but it allows only one null value. That is the difference between primary key column and unique constraint. Apart from this, for a single table, you can create multiple unique constraint. Single table, I just write it here, because it's difficult to, in the case of unique constraint, store unique values. You can store unique values in a table, in a tables column, okay? And also, it allows only one null value. You can create more than one unique constraint. For a table. So now you might have another question. Create more than one unique constraint for a single table. Similarly, can I create more than one primary key for a single table? No. You can have only one. You can create only one primary key to a table. You cannot create multiple primary key to a table. You can have only one primary key. You can create only one primary key to a table, but you can create, composite primary key. See, in this case, look here. I have created a primary key on a single column, isn't it? Employee number. So is there any way I can create primary key for more than one column? This is called, let's say I have department number. So in this case, I can create a primary key for the combination of two columns, employee number and department number. If we go back to this one, you see here, the John is employed is 101 and he belongs to department number 10. But the same John, 104 and department number, both of them are same, right? Though both the department number are same, for the John, the employee ID is different. Supposing he belongs to department number 30 or department number 20. So though the employee names are same, the employee ID is different and department number is different. With the combination of employee ID and the department ID, you can find out the John who belongs to IT department, which is nothing but department number 20. Composite primary key also you can create it. I'll give you another example for a good example for composite primary key little later. At this moment, you just keep this in mind. Okay. But anyhow, to learn Power BI, you don't need to learn all these things because multiple skill sets are required nowadays. Hence, you should be knowing these basic things. Okay. So only one primary key you can create, you can have it for a table, but you can create a primary key for the, you can create a composite primary key by combining more than one column. Okay. But whereas in the case of unique constraint, even in the case of unique constraint, you can create the composite unique ID. More than one column, you can create a unique constraint, but you can have more than one unique constraint. You can create it for a table, but it allows only one null value. Okay. So that is the difference between these two. Hope you understood, what is not null constraint, why it is, why we need to enforce not null constraint, why we need to enforce primary key, foreign key, unique constraint. Next we will see check constraint. When do we have to use check constraint and default constraint? Look here, check constraint. For example, you want to enforce a rule for salary column. I don't want any, salary should be more than zero. This salary column should not, or you say, right, more than zero, you should not have negative values. Salary column should not have negative values. So in that case, what you do is, right, your table creation script will be something like this. I'm going to create different table name. For example, to demonstrate that, I use something like 2-2. And here what I do is, along with this salary column, I just say check salary is greater than zero, because salary column should not have negative value in it. But when you copy paste it like this, you need to make sure that the constraint name also you are going to change it. Okay. Don't worry about the constraint and all. Okay. At this moment, employee 22, already an object named. Okay. Already I gave some other demo. I just go ahead and execute it. Yes, this table got created. So now if I try to insert any negative value in this table, it will throw an error. For example, we will validate it. Now it's up. Always go to test with your table definition or any logic with the data. Okay. I just go ahead and take the data, which is already there in my thing here. Good scripts. I just pick up from here any one of the rows and I'll try to store or insert a negative value for the salary column. Anyhow, this is a brand new table. I don't have to but here I need to change the table name to 222. And let's see, this is what my salary. I try to insert a negative value in this one. Let's see what happens here. Look here, insert statement conflicted with check constraint. The conflict occurred in the database. Check constraint That means you're not supposed to insert negative values. Likewise, you can enforce some rules here. Okay, the business logic can specify it. Okay, and apart from this, let's say I have another column. Okay, and here the marital status. Marital status is care of one, and here I say default. This is for the default constraint. Here I say by default, if you don't enter it, that means they are single. Just think that way, okay? I just go ahead and say press F5, and in this case we have this check constraint on the salary column, and in this case what we'll do to test this, I'm going to say the ename comma job comma MGR comma hire date comma salary is, let's say, no, I'm going to give some good number, otherwise it will throw an error, and commission is, let's say, null. If you don't want to insert any value for a specific column, you can say null, because the commission is not a not null column, hence you can store null value also, not because not all employees are eligible for commission. The department number, let's say 20, and the next one is the marital status. Here I made a mistake. Here you need to say the salary and all the column names, okay, and department number. And here in this case I'm going to say the same, because this record was not inserted anyhow, so I'm going to say 500, and the last one was department number. After this, yes, department number is 10 and commission is null. You need to match this one with this. Look here. For this column, you need to compare the values here. How many columns are there? 3, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and on. Here more values are there. This is ename, job, okay, employee number, okay, let us say employee number. EMP number is important. EMP. Number. EMP number, comma, ename. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 column. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 values are there. Here I did not mention marital status. Okay, did I create this table? Yes, I created it. Let me insert these values. Yeah, it got inserted. Now I'm going to select star from employee. Look here, I did not specify any value for the marital status. I'm sorry, here, sorry, employee 222, what is the table name? Sorry, this is 223, right? 223. Look at the values stored in marital status. Though I did not specify any value for marital status here, the default value, whatever I mentioned it here, got stored here. So in the real-time scenario, when do we use default constraint? For example, the order date. You have a column called order date. Let's say customer is ordering it today. Some items they are ordering it in your website. The order date, whatever the time or day which they are raising it, it should capture that particular day's date, isn't it? So in that case, you can use the order date is nothing but the sys date, current date. There is a function, sys date or get date function is available, okay? Sys date function or current underscore timestamp is available. So if you specify, for example, select current time, so you don't need to remember the function name also, right? So that much simple here, fi. But only challenge is lot of for the order day, you just specify current default. Default, it's a year instead of marital state. You have order day, and here you say date data time or date time. If you are very particular, date time also to store it. Date time is a data type. Along with the date, time also will get stored. The default, what you do is you specify current timestamp. So you want to know not only which day they raise the order, what time they raise the order or the order has been generated. So in that case, use date time data type and use current timestamp to so default. By default, you don't have to insert the value for the current timestamp behind the scene automatically, because you defined it as part of the table definition itself. Here, order date, date time, default, inside the bracket, inside the parenthesis you mentioned about current timestamp. You don't have to manually insert it automatically, since you have defined it at the table level. Whenever an order getting generated, along with the order details, the current timestamp will get stored automatically. For that purpose, we use default constraint. And check constraint, yes, while loading the data itself, check if the salary column has negative value. So in that case, you reject it. Don't store it. Now you understood all these constraints, not null constraint and primary. Not null example is insurance. The age column should have values in it. And also the price column should have value in it. Quantity column, because someone raised an order, that means definitely they would have raised, you know, they would have ordered something. Quantity column should not be zero. And price should not be zero. And the primary column should not be zero. Not null constraint, you understood. And primary key, using primary key, you can uniquely identify an instance from a table. Using foreign key, you can create a relationship between tables. And also you can prevent the anomalies, right? Storing some junk values in your detailed table, so foreign key column, okay? And unique constraint is helpful to create more than one unique constraint on a single table. Using unique constraint also, you can create composite unique constraint, and also you can store null value in the unique, in the case of the column which you created it as a unique constraint. Check constraint, you can create, you can specify the business logic, okay? And default, and you can store. You don't have to explicitly insert the values in all the columns. If you don't receive any value, or simple example, the current timestamp. Got it? So next one is, we will look at the joins. So what are the types of joins that are available? I know, guys, it's painful continuously attending this session, right? 2 hours. But anyhow, please be, because you are joining from different time zones, right? So we'll finish it off, in quickly. So inner join, these are the types of joins are available. Inner join, left join, right join, full join, self join, Cartesian join. What is inner join? Inner join is matching values between the two columns, two tables. If you wanted to retrieve the data from, let's say you want to retrieve the data from two tables, but whatever the values that are in table A, that the corresponding value should be selected from the table B also. Okay. The classic example is this one, the employee and department number table, right? So you'll take the simple example. I will give you another, tougher complex exercises. Try with that. See, in this table, we have department number. If you look at the department number column, 20, 30, 10 is there. And then here I have select star from department table is there. Okay, I'm going to insert a record in department table. Insert into depart values. Let's say I'm going to say 999, something like that. Okay, comma, something like common. In software industry, they say bench, right? Currently you are on bench, that means you are not a billable resource. They say you are into Australia. Okay, I wanted to join the employee table and department table. Okay, and the depart numbers, whatever is there in the depart number table, that should be matched with my employee table's department number column. Okay, so it should exclude the 999. Okay, I'm going to insert one more record in my employee table. Here I'm going to insert some. This one painful thing, or best thing, what I do is select star from inserting the data. From employee. Here we can see the department number. All the employees are falling in this one, right? Whatever the department number that are there in the department table correspond to that, right? We assign the employees. Now what I do is I will take the Miller's data. I'm going to update this one. I'm going to change the department number of Miller to something else. Okay, update employee. Oh, it'll throw an error because we have created the foreign key, isn't it? Science, it'll not. Anyhow, we can see that one also. Update employee table, set the department number as, let's say, 1, 2, 3, something like that, where the where condition is very much important when it comes to update statement. Don't ever forget this. Employee number is equal to 7934. Since we have created the relationship between these two tables, department and department table and employee table, based on the common key column department number, right? See, it is not allowing me to insert a department number 1, 2, 3 in this table because the 1, 2, 3 is not there in my department table. I thought of showing something else. Anyhow, in the department table, we can insert it. Now what we want to do is we want to select all the values from my department table. So, okay, inner join. First, we'll start with inner join. Select ename. Now let us see how we can join more than one table. So ename comma d dot d name from the employee as we join with the department table as D on E dot depart number is equivalent to D dot depart number. How many of you remember the set theory? In school time we studied 14 rows. 14, all the records in my employee table, right? All the records in my employee table or all the employees in my employee table mapped to the department number which were listed in my department table except 999. The department table we have, or okay, I'll just display the department name also, E dot depart number. What is E dot depart number, D dot D name? If you go the proper syntax to and learn it right, it will take longer time. This is a shortcut way to learn it. Look here, I have given an alias to the table employee as E. Instead of typing employee every time, I just given some alias name. For example, every people have alias, right? Okay, here join the employee table with department table, combine these two tables. To combine this table, we need to use join. The employee tables I need to join with this table, department table, based on which key column, department number and department number. So here I used E, so the employee tables I call as a E and department table I call it as a D. What is ED? E represents employee. E is an alias, D is an alias for department table. So E dot depart number, I need to match these two values, isn't it? Since E dot department number is equal to D dot department number. I did this perfectly, correct? So, but here, why should I specify depart number? Because department number column is available in both the table. How does SQL Server will know you want to select the department number from the employee table or department table? Sir, if you don't specify the alias for the department number, because the depart number column is available in both the table. If you don't do it, ambiguous column name. It says I'm getting confused. Can you tell me from which table I have to fetch the department number? Because in both the table, department number column is there. So in that case, E dot department number. So department name is available in my department table. Hence, I need to specify D dot D name. For example, here I'm going to remove the D name. It is not going to throw any error. Look here, because the department name is available on the department table only. Since you have the department number is available in both the table, you need to tell SQL Server, hey, you need to fetch the depart number from the employee table. E is nothing but employee, but you need to specify dot here, followed by E, you need to specify dot here. But in the table name, the list of tables that you specified here, in the from clause, you specify as keyword to define the alias. Hope you understood. It's pretty clear, isn't it? So this is called inner join. Why I call this inner join? Because we join these two table based on the common column, matching value of both the column. For example, I'll just show you with the Venn diagram. So this is my set A and I have set B. This is my A and B. Inner join, the common value between these two tables. For example, here I have 1, 2, 3, 4. Here I have 1, 2, 4, 6, 3 is there. What are the common value between these two tables? 1, 2, the intersection. 1, 2 and 4. So this is what called as inner join. You are joining these two set values based on the common value. So that is what your inner join. What is left join? What is left join? Look at this one. What is left join here? Select all the values from the left side. So in the AB, if you look at these two data set, these two set, the left join, in the case of left join, select all the values from this table, 1, 2, 3, 4, and the matching values between these two tables. Okay, so what are the matching values? 1, 2, 4. Matching values, but or we can say this way also, matching values between these two tables and non-matching value from this table. 1, 2, 4 is available here in this table, in the right side also. So hence you select, it will fetch 1, 2, 4, and 3 is not available here. Sorry, 3 is also, okay, I'll just remove 3 here, forget about 3 here, okay, you don't have, let's say, you know, here you don't have 3 here, okay, 1, 2, 4, 6, and 1, 2, 3, 4, so 1, 2 is common here, 4 is also common, but 3 is one odd man out. Matching values between two tables, non-matching value from the left side table. Or you just think that all the values from your left side table and the matching value between these two table. The right side join is right join. Right join is opposite. Sorry. Yeah, you can, let's put it this way. The right join is, let's say you have AB and here you have 1, 2, 4, 6 and here you have 1, 2 and 3, that's all. So display all the values from the right side of the table. What are they? 1, 2, 4, 6 and the matching value between these two tables. So matching value is obviously 1, 2. This one is matching. So 1, 2. Apart from this, the remaining 4, 6 from the right side you selected. So what kind of situation you will be using left join? What kind of situation you will be using right join? Can someone give me some real-time example? For example, we sell 100 products. Okay, we sell 100 products. That doesn't mean every month all the 100 products we are selling. Only probably some part of the products. For example, 60 products only this month we sold. The remaining 40 products we did not sell it. I just wanted to know which all products we did not sell along with the product that we sold it. In that case, you can use left John. Right John, when will you use it? When will you use right John? Okay, we will start look at the left joint now quickly in the studio. So I'm going to use now the same thing, left joint. Here what I do is I use, look here, instead of here, okay, I say depart here. Look here, I'm going to change the position here. What is the left side table here? Department table. Look here. It selected all the values from the employee table whose department number is 10, 20, 30. But for the department number, which one? Okay, I'll just display both here. Select star from depart. I execute these two things so that you can see it in a single screen. Look here. In this case, this is my department table. Here 10, 20, those employees belong to 10, 20, 30, 40. You know, they are 40 is not there already in my employee table. For operations, 40. Yeah. For the department number 40, there is no employee assigned. So hence it shows null in the employee name column and the department number column. So this is my employee table, okay? The employee table also I have department number. The E name null. That means in the operations department we did not assign any employee. And also in the bench also we don't have anyone. That means currently everybody is allocated in the project or department, various department. But in the operations department, we are yet to assign people. Okay. So those people assigned, those people did not assign. We want to see it. Yes, we are able to see this one. If I change this query, the order of this query, order of the table, what will happen? The opposite. Here, employee as E. When you change the order of the table in the case of left join, the output will be differing. This is very important. But in the case of inner join, if you change the order of the table in your from clause, the output will not change. One second, I'll explain that one. I just executed it. My mouse is causing problem. One second. Look here. Left side. What is my left side employee? The output is different, isn't it? The previous output and the current output is different. In this case, the employee. All the data from the left side table. In this case, the left side is employee, right side is department. All the values from the employee table and the corresponding matching department number between these two table related employees, right? You display it here, it is displaying it. But here, when you change the order of the table in the from class, the result set changes. You need to keep that in mind. Ideally, I should not have modified that query. So always don't modify the query, copy paste it and then you modify it. That is the best practice in real time. You can improve productivity. If you want to get back to the previous query, you need to use Control Z. And you are gone. Probably you can show it somewhere and then you do Control Z. That is another way of doing it. The order, see left joint. Sorry. Here I did not use left joint, right? I should have used left joint. Sorry. I should have used left joint. Same thing only, left joint. Here also left joint. Let us compare these two. Mm. the employee. Okay, here, okay, the left side I change up. Now I change the department. I shouldn't have. See, now the order of the table got changed, the output also changed now. Now null we see at the end, left join, now understood, isn't it? Similarly, the right join, you know, because we don't have any, you know, all the department number, what, since we have enforced the foreign key constraint on the employee table, we are unable to store a depart number which is different from the employee department table's department number. So if you use right join, let's say you have something like that. For example, I'm going to drop the constraint. How do I drop the constraint? To demonstrate that, I'm going to drop that constraint. What is my employee table? Alter table, employee, drop constraint. I think I mentioned about foreign key, depart number, constraint, constraint name. Yeah, I don't remember the, okay, if you want to see the constraint, I don't know if that one, see here something called exegote, sp help, and employee. Thought of using the command to view the columns, or else you just go here and see the constraints name here. Okay, where is the, okay, I'm using dummy table database. Where is the employee table here? This is the one. I just go and see the keys here. Look here, FK department number. In the employee table, we have something called, the constraint name is FK department number. Spelling for constraint. Oh, very good. Good that. Thanks for coming for my rescue. Good. Now I drop the constraint in my employee table. You can also visually see it here in the employee, right? When you expand this one, the key kind of thing. When you see the icon key here, that means the primary key. But this key is not black colored one. So white key. That means the foreign key. So here I drop the foreign key constraint. Now I'll try to insert or the modify the value. For example, select star from employee. With this, I'm going to end the session. Sorry, all of you are tired. So look, department number. I just change Miller's department number to some other value. Update employee, set the depart number as 123 or 333, where employee number is equal to 7934, the last record. I just go ahead and press F5, it got changed. I just cross verify whether it got updated. Yes, 333. For Turner, the department is 333. Now we want to, we are doing some kind of exercise. We want to check, are there any, any odd values entered into the employee table's depart number value. So in that case, I'm going to pick up the same query. Instead of left join, I'm going to use right join here. So we use right join for identifying some kind of exceptional cases to generate external exceptional report. Employee IC right join department number. Okay, all the values from your employee table and the matching value from your department table. So all the values from your employee table, department number 33 is not coming. Ename department from employee IC, right join. We are doing joining. Okay. What we do? We need to change the order here. Right side table, right? We need to use the right side, not this query. Employee. And here on the right side, employee used it, correct. All the values from the right side table. Right join. Look here. Miller though Milner's department number 333 was not there in the department table, it displays Milner record also. But the department name, it shows null. That means there is an exception here. This guy, there is a typo here, right? Or they mentioned wrong department number. If you mention something like this, right, the department number in the department table use 10, 20, 30, 40, but in the employee table you use different value for the department number, then there is a inconsistency here. Are there any inconsistencies are there in my data? To find out that, you can use this type of right join and left join, and again some other business case also we'll be using right join. We'll see it as part of the demo database related tables. There you will find a lot of tables. I will share the exercise probably sometime early morning tomorrow. You can start work on it. Now let us see. Now we learnt about inner join, right join. Fine. Quickly, I will help you out creating. Sorry guys, I am taking much of your time. I'll not take more than 5 minutes. Okay, we have something called Adventure database. Okay, we need to install that one. So what you do, you just go to the browser. I'll just share the link, quickly download and install it so that all the next 5 days you can start practice it. Look at here. I'll just share this link to you all in the chat window. Go to this site, click on it in the chat window. Check the chat window. I just send the link. Go to that URL, and if you scroll down on this page, on the right side you will find SQL samples repository. Okay, if you click on Microsoft SQL Server samples, or I'll just share this link directly to you all. Okay, and let me just check if this has samples. Yeah, I'll just go there directly, and databases, AdventureWorks, and data warehouse install script. Oh, it's all available in CSV format. One second, not this URL, wait for some time. And I'll just, okay, I'll just go directly here. One second. See, you just go to your C drive, directly go there. Okay, I'll show you this one. Go to program files. Go to program files, and then you will find SQL Server, Microsoft SQL Server. In this, you will find another SQL Server, MS SQL. If you click on it, you will find somewhere the MySQL and sample. We don't see the sample here. One second. Data. So click on data. Oh, not data, backup. Sorry, backup. Backup folder. Backup folder. I just share this link also. Most of you have used the default installation, right? You did not change the installation folder or during the time of installation. It must be there in the copy paste it, you will find it here. But you will not find these files. You need to download it. What I will do is probably I will upload it in my website, and then I'll share that link. You download it and put it under backup folder. In this folder, you need to keep these two files. Right? You need to download it from my website and then put these two files in this folder. The next step is pretty simple. Go to the studio, right click on databases, sorry, click on database, and when you right click on it, you will find restore database. Click on restore database and then select device. And when you click on this, in this one, you need to click on add. When you click on add, you will find this one. Whatever I showed you in my operating system, that you can see it here. Okay, the restore database in Management Studio points to this folder by default. Okay, so you find this one and you need to select this one. When you select this one, look here, it got added here. Click on OK. Next, blindly close your eyes, click OK. It will take few minutes to install it. Okay, installed successfully, you'll get it. Okay, next, what you need to do is you need to go back to the other file, select the other file, this one, the same way you need to, or you know, I'll just show you one more time. Just go to this one, right click, restore database, next device, and click on this ellipsis, click add, and you will find the second one. This is for data warehouse related tables. When you click on OK, it will get linked. This is really, really helpful if you want to learn SQL, or if you want to learn, look here, in this case I clicked OK mistakenly. It says something failed because already I installed it. Okay, already I restored this one, and that's the reason it was saying that. So this is how you need to do it. Okay, I will share today's video. Watch my video. It's recorded. So you watch my today's video and then install it. Very simple one. And also I will send you the assignments sometime tomorrow morning. Next 5 days you are free. Whenever you are free, I'm not saying you're free, right? Whenever you get free for the next 5 days, you start practicing, right? All the assignments. In that way you can build up your knowledge in SQL queries. And also we can little bit fast track the training. Most likely what we will do is we will start with the Power BI session from next Saturday, and in the meanwhile you work on the assignments, and then you can, whatever the assignment that I send it to you, right, you work on it and then you submit it. I'll send you the link wherein you can submit the assignment solutions. Okay, and the complex queries, what you do is probably you can give it a try, but for example, if you want to join more than two table, right, it will take some. The advanced part probably we can take it up later. As of now, whatever you learn, you know, with this knowledge you can try those assignments. Those you cannot take it, you cannot complete it, keep it, right? We will probably carry forward later sometime, and we will better start Power BI, because other members, right, they want me to start Power BI because it's already, you know, 2 hours because of vacation, all the things, right, it got postponed. We'll try to start Power BI next week, and the complex part of the query also, we'll see it later. All right, is it sounds good? Okay, or else you send me if you have any concern or anything, right? You can WhatsApp me, or you can WhatsApp to my people, they will get back to me. Okay, fine. So start practicing the assignment, watch my video, and wherever you get stuck, you pause my video and start practice it. And also we'll share the scripts, whatever I gave you a demo today. I'll share all the scripts with the data set, everything, and you can practice it. And also I'll share the link where you can download the Adventure Works files. One is OLTP, other one is Data Warehouse. All right, fine, thanks. Any questions so far? Fine, since you don't have any questions, I'm going to wrap up now. See you next weekend.